should have at least two more of these this semester, provided that we all behave ourselves and stay on campus.
Yeah.
I think I heard today that Virginia Tech is well over 600 cases of COVID. And our dashboard still says less than 10. So I don't know if that's 7.2, 6.3, 9.5. I don't know what less than 10 means.
That's a stressful gesture.
But I guess we're afraid of like some kind of security of information or something. I don't know what we're afraid of there. But anyway, we have less than 10. We're excited about that. Just wanted to kind of give you a couple of quick announcements about just things going on around the house, and just make a couple of quick COVID announcements about the house. We are going to try to start up our Zoom link here in just a couple minutes if it's not already started, but we're going to generally start our meeting with announcements, and so Molly's going to come up and do that. But before she does, when we're going to leave our tables up because it's already 6 o'clock anyway. This will kind of keep us our spacing a little bit, so a few more people can get there, a few people can sit there, maybe one or two here as we go. You are welcome to Zoom in on the deck, whatever, as we kind of get, as we start approaching 50 and 60 people tonight. That's not what happened. Anyway, all that's But we're excited, and we're excited for all of our Zoom people. So we've got camera equipment, we've got microphones, we've just got new things happening. So just kind of be cognizant of that, and don't kick things around or whatever when you anyway. Yeah. The main thing here with this is if we wear masks and we wash our hands a lot, we've got 98% of this licked. You do not need to worry so much more after that. But with that said, I was studying today, looking at research and stuff like that. If we just wash these tables with soap and water, just the kind of the same thing you do with your hands, we're generally good. We'll probably have an alcohol solution later to do that, but we're not going to tear them down tonight. Maybe at our next meeting we'll tear them down. That's kind of the process of that. If you're using the house, we will try to have the alcohol solution out for you to spray. If you want to use that, that's fine. But basically, if you use something in the kitchen or whatever, soap and water, dishwater, the dishcloth, and wiping down surfaces is probably enough. There's hand sanitizer around, wash your hands a lot kind of thing, wear your mask in here. The last thing I want to say about the room limits, we have caps on the rooms. The library and the conference room upstairs, mathematically, can have 10 people in them by using the mathematical formula of what the spacing is. But that sounds like a lot. We're not supposed to ever have over 10 people at any gathering at any time on this campus, generally speaking, so we're gonna try to abide by that. So at any other time than our Sunday night gathering, we're not supposed to have more than 10 in this room. As you approach 10 in this room, somebody needs to kind of move along. You have to divide into groups and stuff like that. In the library, that may be you have 10 in there, kind of keep them in small groups of 4 or 5, whatever you're going to do. Remember, the deck is in great shape. We want to thank May for her work on that, Josh and Zeka for their work on that. My wife has kind of prettied it up tonight. Y'all need to take a look at that before you get out of here tonight, and just take a look at that. The front porch is great, because just use the house however you want to use it. As long as you're wearing masks, washing your hands, use this space. Make it great. I know that y'all have a lot of studying to do. I just heard the table's doom over here. This is awful what's going to happen for y'all this week. So anyway, depth, not breadth. I think that's what they mean by academic test, right? Examinations. Depth. They want a lot of examinations for you. The depth of examinations. Anyway. Very good. Let's begin our time together. And Molly, why don't you come up here and introduce us to the announcements for the week?
We have some announcements.
Awesome.
Tribe Link. If you're signed in, you're probably part of the Tribe Link. But if you're not, join it. If there's anyone watching who was on Zoom and wants to show up in person at some point, go to the link. It'll be really helpful for everyone here. Family groups, they're still meeting. And now that we're in person, there's like a good mix of in-person and with Zoom options as well. If you're not comfortable coming in person, just contact the leaders. They'll let you know where they're meeting. It'll also be in the email. And if you're not involved, it's not too late to join. Just you can join at any point in time. Just check them out.
Yes, just real briefly, I've made this announcement a couple weeks now. I really think a lot of this, Kairos Leadership Initiative, I will probably show the video next week that's a little bit more enticing possibly. You can actually see that video already if you go to the website. But a great experience, mostly spring semester, starts with a weekend event in January, a week-long event in May. There's mentoring, there's coaching involved. This is a very intensive thing about leadership. My hope is for you next semester that your academic intensity will not be as strong as this semester. But all I have to say is the bookending of things is before and after your semester. But anyway, the leadership things that we do in this is fantastic. So be considering it. Deadline is October 2nd. I need to write a reference for you. If you have any questions about this, please talk to me. I'd love to talk to you a little bit more about this opportunity.
All right. That's even better than I thought it was going to be. So, Emily Diley, she has planned a virtual paint night. She's going to be here tonight, but it's going to be on Saturday, the 25th. The time will be in the email for tomorrow. She's still working on that. She's going to be putting together paint kits for everyone. You can come by the house, pick up, or maybe someone can drop it off to you if you're not comfortable coming by the house. The deadline to sign up for the kits will be the Tuesday, 22nd, so she has time to get everything together. And it'll just be a little fun night where everyone can be at their own pace, own little space in their dorm, whatever, and have some fun painting and take a break from classes.
So, Molly, is that Friday the 25th?
It might be a Friday.
The 25th is a Friday. She did not say Saturday. She said the 25th, right?
She might have said Saturday the 25th, so it'll be correct in the email, whatever it is.
There you go.
I'll double check. So, all right.
Emily Barley says it's Friday. She just messaged.
Oh, sounds great.
Oh, we have people at home checking in. There you go.
Awesome. Thank you. So, yeah, Friday the 25th. I was wrong. We got it fixed in the email for sure.
Perfect,
it's
okay.
Oh. I think that was Janine's slide.
Hi. As instructed by Zach, I'm doing it. The opportunity to be a quote taker was left to me by Zach, who was a graduate last year, if you don't know. And so I'm doing a quote list. If you hear something at the BCM house or like in a group of BCMers that's like quote worthy, you can send it to me and I will add it to my official list and share it probably at the end of the year. So if I get quotes from other people, it's less likely that I'm just going to be like adding random quotes that I think are interesting, so there'll be a better balance. So.
Wait, we're in the house. There's some rules. It's open 10 to 10. Gotta wear your mask like you are now. Continue washing your hands. It's mostly what Jeffrey has gone over already. The rooms, they have their limits. Respect social distancing. As long as we are following these, we're good. And we can keep coming here. So, that's it. It's worship time.
One more announcement that Molly and I were miscommunicated with her. I'd like to give her an announcement. Next Sunday morning is an opportunity that we have to do like a virtual checking in with one of our mission partners in Ghana. And our BCM has sent various teams over there over the years. We've had four groups to go actually at various times. And it's an opportunity to really just kind of check in with a church happening in a village. I don't know exactly how it's all going to work, but we're going to be able to ask some questions. I get to introduce you to a great friend, Emmanuel Mustafa, and he has a fascinating testimony, and I'd love for you to hear about his work that he does in Ghana. If enough of you get excited about it, we could maybe even work on trying to get a trip together for those days long from now. We get to return to normalcy and take trips together and fly to places. Anyway, all I'd say is we're excited about that. That time is going to be 10 a.m. next Sunday. In the email tomorrow by announcements, you should hear exactly how to sign up for that. But you don't really need to sign up for that as much as I just need to kind of know if a few of you are going to be there. Anyway, that's the main thing about that. But I'll have some more details of that in the email tomorrow. Any other announcements? I should have done on camera.
I'm not going to do that. now. If you all want to stand up or not, whatever you all feel like. So before we start, just if you all want to join worship team, if you play guitar or bass or sing or whatever you play, we'd love to have you. If you play the harmonica, we will find a way for you to play. Figure something out. Maybe. So if you all want to join worship team, we'd love to have you. Also, if you all have any song suggestions, there should be something in the group chat tomorrow and the email, next email hopefully, for you to submit song requests, or you could just message me if you have some ideas. Also, just for tonight, as much as we would love to hear you all sing, I know I promised whenever we're back in person we'd be singing, but sadly we can't, so no singing this time. You have to keep your mask on. If you truly feel like you have to sing and you have to let it out, if you can keep it down to a, you know, a whisper or a mumble, that's what we have to do for right now. Hopefully, sooner rather than later, we can get back to normal, loud worship. But we're not going to let that stop us from having a good time, from worshiping. So we're going to start with Seasons Change.
Thank you. you so much. Just for the chance to be together in the presence of your Spirit. I know it's difficult when we want to sing out and we can't to protect those around us, Lord, but I just pray that your Spirit would fill us and that we would just be drawn into the power of your presence, and that we don't need to speak or to voice anything out loud for you to know where our hearts are, Lord. And I just thank you for the chance to gather and to see each other in this community. I thank you for everyone that's there on Zoom as well, just that we're united in the body of Christ, even when we can't see each other, Lord, and when we can't do things as normal. Your power overcomes that, and your Spirit overcomes that. Just be with Ben as he brings the message tonight, and give us open and willing hearts to hear it. In Christ's name we pray.
Worship team, that was amazing. It's awesome to at least be able to hear the music and kind of meditate on those words, even though we can't belt out the words. So a quick heads up for tonight. I am super glad to be bringing the message. It's an honor again. But we're going to be in Ephesians tonight. We're going to continue where Will left off. We're going to be in Ephesians 1, chapter 1, verses 15 through 23. I do want to provide a little bit of context with what we're working with here. So last week on Zoom, Will did a fantastic job of the first 14 verses. Thank you for that. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to work through these last few verses. So, as Will told us last week, Paul is writing this letter to the people of the ancient city of Ephesus, right? The beginning of the book is telling them that they are forgiven of their sins because of what Jesus did, and that they now have an inheritance with Christ in heaven, and that applies to us too. We can be put in that position of Paul is talking to us as well. So, Paul's first interaction with these people, the Ephesians, was actually after his conversion experience. I can't speak to what happened before then, but the first recorded interaction is in Acts 19. He was on a missionary journey throughout the Mediterranean countries, and I always love reading about his time in Ephesus, and I would really love to tell you more about it because it's really, really cool, but I don't have enough time. It's a lot to work through, even though it's nine verses, but we're going to get through it. What is important to know for tonight's message is that Paul really, really, really loved these people. He loved the Ephesians, and not that he didn't love the other people he went on missionary journeys to, but with these guys, it's like the word of God went out of its way to say that he loved these people, that there was a special connection. They had been through riots and persecution together, and when it was time for him to depart for Jerusalem, Paul gives this beautiful going away speech in Acts 20. And at the end of this, in Acts 20, 36 through 38, it says, "And after he had said these things, he knelt down and prayed with them all, and there was much weeping on the part of all. They embraced Paul and kissed him, being sorrowful most of all because of the word he had spoken, that they would not see his face again, and they accompanied him to his ship." This is where we are with Paul and the Ephesians, right? They loved each other, and Paul is writing to this group of people that he had to leave. But, of course, there was always an unwavering hope that they would see each other again. So, with that in mind, with that bit of context, let's read what Paul has to say to the Ephesians in verses 15 through 23. Would anybody like to read the passage? It's up here. Feel free to use a Bible.
I'll do it.
You got it? All right, thanks, Caroline. Take it away.
I'm just going to read it from mine because I've had it written far away. For this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for God's people, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know to hope
So, Paul is not really known for his short sentences. That was two sentences in nine verses. And one of them is really, really long. He just has a lot to say. So, I'm going to try to work through it. So, let's see what we got. Let's look at this together. The first thing that we see in this wonderful section of Scripture is the love that Paul has for these people. He has great affection for them, and he desires to see them fulfill their calling, what God has called them to. So, can we go to this? Yeah. And one more? Okay, yeah. So, first, we're Baptists, so we like alliteration. We consider the calling. That's what happened. He considers the calling of the people that God has given these people, right? Paul knows that what God has in store for these people is for the church at Ephesus, rather, it's a blessing beyond all measure. He says that he always remembers to pray for them, praying that they would receive this amazing spirit of wisdom and of revelation and the knowledge of him. You see, when we are saved, we receive a calling that is unlike any other. You guys ready to hear it? It's a call to die. We are called to die to our old self, spiritually, of course. We're called to spiritually die to our old self and then be completely born again as a new person. In other words, we're called to put off the old self, the self that loves sin, and then we are to take on the new life to which God has called us. A life of, as we see here, it's in verse 17, a life of wisdom and of revelation and the knowledge of God. And in verse 18, we see that we're also called to a hope. And this hope is not really like the hope that we would think of it today. We may say, I hope that next semester we don't have to wear masks, or I hope that I get good grades in my classes, without really knowing if this is going to happen. This is not a hope like we see in the Bible. The hope that it's talking about here is an assurance. We're sure that because Christ has saved us, we will be with him forever. It's a guarantee. As you know, I'm on CT, which is coordination team this year, and I'm super excited for the rest of the group to be officially introduced after I'm done. But, beloved friends, this is our prayer for you. This is my prayer for you. This is Jeffrey's prayer for you. This is all of CT and the family group leaders. This is the staff's prayer for you guys. We want you to see this revelation and to know this hope Paul is talking about. I love you guys so much. I really do. And all of us, the servant leaders, we love you guys so much. And we want to have that kind of relationship with you that Paul had with those Ephesians back in Acts. It's our desire for us to grow as a community in knowledge and love of God, and to have the eyes of our hearts enlightened to him as we read his word. We want you to be passionate about running after God. This is what it's all about, right? It's all about him. It's all about Jesus. All of this, all of the campus that's behind me, all of creation, every life that has ever existed, it is all about Jesus' glory. Let's look at one of these words in verse 17 again. Wisdom and of revelation and the knowledge of him. Paul is asking that God would give the church at Ephesus wisdom and revelation of God so that we may know him better, as Caroline's translation said. So, that word, revelation. It's a very interesting word. The Greek word is apokalypsis, which is where we get our word apocalypse, right? And that's all that word really means. It doesn't necessarily mean the end of the world. It means just the revealing of something. It means that something that was hidden is now being shown. I want to invite you to think about that for a moment. Let's think about that. So, the last book of the Bible, as most of you know, is Revelation, right? Same word here, apocalypsis, that's what it's called. It's chock full of metaphors and about the end times and really deep theology that no one really that has read it has ever really been able to fully flesh out, although we know a little bit. But I do want to pose this question to you. What is being revealed in that book? What's being revealed? There are a few things. You can raise your hand. Throw something out there, yeah.
I would say it's revealing the story of God's people and what will happen when, like, the end times.
Okay, yeah, the end times. What's something else? I'm looking for something in particular, shamelessly. I'm looking for something. But that is totally correct. Totally correct. Yes, Janine?
Revealing some of human history from a different perspective.
Okay, yes.
Cosmic level of it.
Mm-hmm. True. There's something else. Something else.
New heaven and new earth.
Also true. Okay. What I'm looking for is it's revealing who Jesus is. Who Jesus really, really is. There's this passage from Revelation. I'm going to go ahead and flip to it real quick. It's a description of Jesus, and it's one of the only descriptions of Jesus that we get. And it doesn't even say that it's Jesus, but we know, and I'll tell you why in a minute. But I want to read this. This is Revelation 1, 12 through 19. Crazy stuff, so a lot of symbolism here. This is John speaking, then I turned to see the voice that was speaking to me, and on turning I saw seven golden lampstands, and in the midst of the lampstands one like a son of man, clothed with a long robe and with a golden sash around his chest. The hairs of his head were white like white wool, like snow. His eyes were like a flame of fire. His feet were like burnished bronze, refined in a furnace, and his voice was like the roar of many waters. In his right hand he held seven stars. From his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword, and his face was the sun shining in full strength. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead, but he laid his right hand on me, saying, "Fear not, I am the first and the last, and the living one. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and have the keys of death and Hades. Write therefore the things that you have seen, those that are, and those that are to take place after this." So, that's a very vivid description of this person, full of symbolism. But something interesting about this this passage, obviously it's Jesus. He died, and he's alive forevermore. Okay, we got that down. We know this is Jesus. What happens every time a person falls down to worship an angel in Scripture? Angel says, no, don't worship me. Don't do that. I'm not the one that needs to be worshipped. That's not what happens here. He simply lays his hand on John's shoulder and says, "Fear not." So keep that in the back of your head. And then we're going to go back to Ephesians, okay? This is 19 through 23. I'm going to go ahead and read it again. "And what is the immeasurable greatness of his power towards us who believe, according to the working of his great might that he worked in Christ when he, God, raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him as head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all." You see, this is the second thing that the Spirit does for us in this passage. You go ahead and click that. Through Paul, he characterizes Christ. More alliteration for you. But this is wonderful. This is good stuff. I know I'm jumping around Scripture a lot, and I promise it won't happen again, but I'm going to do it one more time because this is good. So Colossians 1, 15 through 20. This is talking about Jesus. "He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. These verses, the Ephesians passage, the Revelation passage, they all point to one being. They point to Jesus. Friends, it is unmistakable that Jesus is God. It is unmistakable. Often I find that our Western thinking wants the Bible just to come out and say Jesus is God. Where's that verse in the Bible? It doesn't need to. This is an Eastern book. It talks around a truth so you get the truth. It says, the fullness of God was to dwell in him. He is supreme. I won't read it now because I told you I wouldn't. But there's another powerful image of him that John gives in Revelation 19, in which he is called faithful and true. He is the first and the last, and there's no one who is equal to him. Do you guys realize what this means? It means we have an advocate that has all power to stop the accusations that Satan hurls at us. Satan is often called the accuser in the Old Testament because he accuses us of our wrongdoings. But because of what Christ did, he is all powerful to say, no, this person is justified according to what I did. It means that we have a personal, loving God who cared about us enough to empty himself of his of being in heaven, to come down and maintain being God, that nature that he has, and then he still died so that we could have a new life. And it means we have a king. We have a king who has authority over all the world. He has control over the coronavirus. He has control over William and Mary. He has a perfect knowledge and control over the weather and the animals and every star all those trillions of light years away. And he has an immeasurable greatness of power that we see in verse 19. And he gives this power to us so that we can overcome whatever trials and temptations that would knock us off our feet so quickly if we were alone. The world can give you some things. The world likes to give you things. It likes to pour into us. But those things don't last. He is the only one who can satisfy our souls. Colossians 2 warns us against trying to search for some worldview that is apart from the one that Christ gives us. Paul says to watch that no one takes you captive by empty philosophy and deceit according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the world, and not according to Christ. Immediately after he says this, he reaffirms again that we can only be truly fulfilled in Jesus, because Jesus is God. These philosophies that we hear about, these complex tenets, these worldviews that make your head spin around and around, I suppose they can be helpful in some ways, but only in Jesus can we have true wisdom and true knowledge. In one of my philosophy classes this week, I learned about the philosophies of this guy named Baruch Spinoza. I don't know, you guys might recognize the name. His philosophy of the nature of God is very pantheistic, which just means that he rejected God as a personal being like we see in the Bible, and thought of God to be in all things and all things. It's weird. But guys, I want to encourage you. Come with me and see these shaky human thoughts and philosophies do not stand when we delve into God's word and see that Jesus is the only way and the truth and the life. He is the fullness that fills all in all that we see in verse 23. So as we go out this week, I have just one thing for us to do tonight, and it's simple. It may not be easy. It's really the only thing that truly matters, though. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Dig deeply into his word. In that Revelation passage in which he's called faithful and true, John tells us that his name, the name of Jesus, the name he is known by, is the Word of God. It's a wonderful picture. I love it. So whenever you're getting into this book, you're learning to know God. You're learning to know Jesus. You're learning to know his nature and his desire for your life. Fix your eyes on him. Spend time with him. Pray fervently. He will be faithful and true on his word, that you will be made holy and perfect in his sight. So let's just take a few moments and reflect on the scripture that we heard tonight. Let's reflect on who Jesus is, his supremacy and his power and his love that he has for us. Be silent, let the Spirit speak so that we think on these things. After a few minutes, I'll go ahead and pray us out, and we'll move on to CT introductions. Lord Jesus, thank you for your word. Thank you for the ways that you reveal yourself to us so that we can know you, so that we can know the love that you have for us, so that we can love you back. God, we don't deserve your love. We don't deserve the life that you gave for us. But you gave it. Thank you for the power that you give us to resist trials and temptations and count it all joy. It's difficult, but you give us the power to do it. As we go about our week, let us continue to fix our eyes on you. That's truly the only thing that matters, because when we do that, we see that we love others as well. We have to love you first in order to love others. We have to know you first in order to love others. God, as you are supreme in all things, let us also remember that you're supreme in our lives. In Jesus' name.